Hey everyone, welcome to our first in the series of EOC review videos. These videos are meant to help students review essential content in preparation for the end of course exam in biology in the state of North Carolina, but they can be used as a refresher on lots of basic biology topics. As you follow along, I encourage you to use resources linked in the video description and go ahead and subscribe if you find this kind of material helpful for your biology review. Let's get started. This first video is going to focus on the structure and function of living organisms, which is about 18 to 22% of the biology end of course exam in North Carolina. It's a good chunk of it, it's not the largest topic, but it's still important. In this video, we're going to cover essential standards 1.1 and 1.2, as well as their objectives, which include topics like prokaryotic and eukaryotic cells, organelles and their functions, cell differentiation, homeostasis, the cell cycle, cell adaptations. But again, this video is meant as review, so we won't have time to touch on everything, just the simplified essentials. So let's get started. Organelles are structures within cells that have specialized functions. And you probably remember a lot of organelles from previous science classes, but we're going to focus today on some of the main ones you'll need to be able to know and recognize by picture, function, or name. So let's look at these two pictures. We have the nucleus, drawn simply here. Plasma membrane, which is the surrounding double layer around the cell, which if we zoomed in closely, we see is a phospholipid bilayer. The cell wall with plant cells and certain prokaryotic cells, and mitochondria, this oval with the squiggly line, our vacuoles here and here, chloroplasts, again, only in plant cells, and ribosomes, represented frequently by little dots. So sometimes you'll see a mitochondrion drawn very technically, and they look a little bit more like this than this simplified drawing here, but sometimes you'll just see an oval with a squiggly line. So you need to be able to recognize both types of pictures. And you'll also potentially see a chloroplast drawn more like this than the one I have in my picture. These are stacks of thylakoids, which are an important part of the chloroplast. Don't really need to focus on that for the biology EOC, just be able to recognize chloroplast as an important organelle with these kind of stack-like structures within a plant cell only. All right, so getting back into the differences between animal and plant cells, which you might remember again from other science classes, plant cells have cell walls and they look kind of like these geometric shapes. Animal cells do not. Plant cells also have chloroplasts where animal cells do not. And plant cells tend to have one large vacuole for water storage where animals can have smaller vacuoles or multiple vacuoles. So make sure you recognize those main differences between plant and animal cells. Those aren't the only differences, but those are key important ones. All right. So recognizing our organelles by picture, again, here's our simplified mitochondrion. This is for energy. So you need to be able to understand that the mitochondria is where the cellular energy is created or made in a process called cellular respiration. You need to know more than just the mitochondria is the powerhouse of the cell. Here are simple circles with kind of a blank space in them. That would be a vacuole, which again is for storage. Our ribosomes are represented by little dots, and this is where proteins are made. Our nucleus is going to be in the center of the cell. Sometimes you'll see chromosomes if the DNA is condensed represented in them, but it's going to store our DNA or our genetic information in eukaryotic organisms, and we'll get to that in a second. Our cell membrane is going to be represented, if we zoom in closely, by this phospholipid bilayer, and its purpose is to provide a semi-permeable barrier, letting some things in and some things out of the cell in order for the cell to maintain homeostasis and do everything that it needs to do. Our cell wall is going to provide structure and support, another layer of protection of the cell, again, not in animal cells, and it's going to be kind of geometric in shape. And our chloroplast is the site of photosynthesis, only in plant cells, so we're not going to see these in animal cells. Now, if we look back at our plant and animal cells, these are both eukaryotic organisms, meaning they have a true nucleus, or they have a nucleus, and other membrane-bound organelles. So organelles like the mitochondria, organelles like vacuoles, and these are generally larger and more complex. Prokaryotic organisms are more primitive. We think they evolved first. They typically only have a few key features. So they're very simple, they're very, very small. They're more abundant on Earth than eukaryotic cells, but they're very different. So in prokaryotic cells, we do not have any of those membrane-bound organelles. We don't have a mitochondria, we don't have vacuoles, we don't have a nucleus. Instead, the DNA is just free-floating within the cell in a feature we call the nucleoid. We do have ribosomes because all cells do make proteins and have to do protein synthesis. We do have a cell membrane to contain the cytoplasm and the essential functions of that and the essential features of that cell. And that's about it. Sometimes there'll be external features like our flagella, which is for movement, or cilia, also for movement. Those are small hair-like structures. I'll show you a picture of one of those later. And those can exist in prokaryotic organisms, but again, not all prokaryotic cells have those. So again, prokaryotic organisms, much more simple, no nucleus, no membrane-bound organelles, very, very simple features. Plant and animal cells are both eukaryotic. So let's talk about cell differentiation. Differentiation is how we get so many types of cells that contain the same DNA in one multicellular organism. Think about your body. All your cells in your body have the same DNA, and you grew from one fertilized egg, but then your cells differentiated, and during the process of differentiation, only specific parts of your DNA are activated, and so your cells start to look a little bit different. So you were able to grow neurons, and you were able to grow muscle cells and bone cells and skin cells. Now, all of those cells can look very different, but they are all going to contain the same DNA because different parts of the DNA are turned on or activated. So the parts of the DNA that are turned on in a cell are going to determine the structure and the function of the cell. And at the very beginning of the organism's development, they have basically the potential to become any type of cell, but once the cell is differentiated, the process can't be reversed. So we can't have a neuron turning into a muscle cell. And so nearly all cells of a multicellular organism have the exact same DNA, exact same chromosomes, but different parts are turned on. All right, so now we're into 1.2, and I want to talk a little bit about homeostasis. And within homeostasis, we need to mention homeostasis as a process, cell membranes, and cell transport. So make sure you're familiar with these ideas. And I do have additional videos that you can go back and use to review if you need a deeper look at some of these topics. So homeostasis is an organism's ability to maintain a stable internal environment suitable for living conditions. It's one of the characteristics of life. All living things must be able to maintain homeostasis to survive, and often the result of not maintaining homeostasis is disease or death, which is really bad. So, some examples of organisms maintaining homeostasis, very simple one is temperature. And for example, we sweat. As body temperatures rise in humans, we sense particular signals that eventually help our sweat glands release our sweat, which is secreted through our skin. And when that is evaporated, we have a cooling sensation, and there's shivering as well. Ectotherms are going to move into an area to get warm in order to maintain homeostasis. So all of this is just one type of maintenance of homeostasis. I have a whole other video on lots of different types of homeostasis and how organisms from multicellular organisms to unicellular organisms maintain those, so please check that out if you need a review of this topic. All right, so getting into cell transport, we need to talk about how organisms maintain homeostasis at the cellular level, and a lot of this involves which molecules can get in and out of the cell. One way is through diffusion, and I also have a cell transport review video, so you can go back and check that out. Diffusion is just the movement of molecules from a high to a low concentration. So when we have a higher concentration here, they're going to naturally move in the direction where there is a lower concentration until an equilibrium is reached, which we call an isotonic solution if there is equal amounts of solute or particles on either side of a membrane. All right, there's also facilitated diffusion where molecules are going to diffuse high to low still, but with the help of a transport protein. And then there's active transport where we need to go in the opposite direction of the concentration gradient. So we're going from low concentration here to high, which again is not the way they're naturally going to move. So ATP or cellular energy needs to be used. And so this is done also with the protein. We're going from low to high and we need to use energy. So again, go back and watch that cell transport video if you need a better refresher on this topic. Osmosis is another type of transport that's really important in maintenance of homeostasis of organisms, and this is the transport of water molecules across a membrane from high to low as well. So you might see a question similar to this on your EOC. A cell is in a beaker with a solution with a higher salt concentration, so salt is going to be my dots, outside the cell than inside the cell. What will happen to the cell? Well, since we aren't informed whether or not this molecule can pass through the membrane, we're going to just have to focus on the movement of water. So if we look here, where is the higher concentration of water, inside the cell or outside the cell? Well, it's going to be opposite of the salt molecules. So because we have a higher concentration inside the cell than outside the cell of water, we're going to see movement of water out of the cell. So the cell will leave, this water will leave the cell. The cell may eventually shrink and shrivel, which is not good, but that's going to be the consequence. All right, again, check out my cell transport video if you want to see more examples of these types of questions or more explanations. In this standard as well, we want to talk about the cell cycle, which is how a typical cell is going to go through its life. And so the main part of a cell's life cycle is called interphase, which involves stages G1, S, and G2. And that takes up the bulk of the cell's activities. So this interphase stage actually lasts a really long time. G1 is for growth, S is for synthesis of the DNA, so where the DNA is duplicated, and G2 is also for growth and preparation for division. After the cell divides, it can continue going through the cycle again and again, as long as the right signals are being processed within the cell. If we zoom in and talk about mitosis and cytokinesis specifically, we're going to look at the main stages of mitosis for how the cell is going to divide its genetic information so that its daughter cells have the exact same stuff as the parent cell. We can remember the stages of mitosis as PMAT, prophase, metaphase, anaphase, and telophase. And if we look on here, prophase involves the DNA condensing, our nuclear membrane dissolving, and our chromosomes sort of migrating to the center of the cell. Metaphase is going to involve those chromosomes lining up in the middle of the cell along the cellular equator, and the spindle fibers are going to start to attach to the centromeres of the chromosomes. In anaphase, those sister chromatids are pulled away, A for away, from each other, and those spindle fibers are going to pull them to opposite ends of the cell. In telophase, we start to get new nuclear membranes reforming, and then in cytokinesis, the cytoplasm is actually going to split, and we're going to have a cleavage, and we're going to get two daughter cells. The DNA is decondensing and going back into chromatin. All right, so again, a couple things to remember about mitosis. In a regular body cell, we're typically going to go from a diploid cell with just the regular amount of chromosomes, which is represented by 2n, to two daughter cells that are also diploid. So in mitosis, we go from diploid to diploid. We go from one cell to two cells, and they have identical genetic information as the parent cell. So the point of this is to make two identical daughters. Now, the DNA has to be duplicated in S phase before it can undergo mitosis, or else if we split the DNA in half without duplication, we would end up with half the DNA in the daughter cells, which is not what we want in the process of mitosis. That's for meiosis, which we'll talk about later on. So S phase has to happen during interphase, this longer stage of the cell cycle, in order for the DNA to be duplicated and we can have enough in order to split it later down the road. Okay, so again, once we've duplicated that DNA in prophase, it's going to condense and get ready for cell division, metaphase line up in the middle, anaphase will pull apart, telophase, we're going to get two new nuclear membranes starting to form, and then cytokinesis, we're going to get cleavage and we're going to cut those cells in half. All right, I want to talk a little bit about cellular adaptations. This again, we go over in more detail in my homeostasis video, so feel free to check that out. But you might see a question on the exam that has something to do with certain adaptations that these cells might have. And if you know what organelles do, you might be able to figure out what is going on. So some of these things, like if we look at this paramecium here and we learn that this paramecium is having trouble with movement, it might ask which organelle is disrupted. And you could say, well, we know that these cilia, these tiny little hairs here, are for movement, so we might think that the cilia are disrupted, which would be the correct answer to a question like that. Over here, we have an amoeba. This amoeba is going to use its contractile vacuole to pump excess water out of the cell. And we're asked, how is this helping the amoeba survive? You could say it's helping it maintain a stable internal environment. So think about this kind of adaptation and think about other things like chemotaxis, cells moving towards a chemical signal, phototaxis, cells moving towards a light signal, all of these things that are going to help single cellular organisms survive in their environments. All right, so that was a very quick review of the structure and function of living organisms. If you need to go back and watch any of this again, I encourage you to do so. We'll have more videos to help you review for the Biology EOC coming soon. Make sure to subscribe and leave any comments if you have questions. Thanks, guys.